Penguin Random House Audio presents Top Dog by Jens Lapidus. Translated from the Swedish by Alice Menzies. Read for you by Jon Lindstrom. Swedish Women's Weekly. Exclusive mingle at Bookarts Exhibition. Cool Art and Bookarts threw an exclusive launch party last night in celebration of their unique art. The event saw Prince Carl Philip and his graphic designer friend Joachim Andersson mingling alongside Stockholm society and the big names of the art world. Our reporter also spotted a couple of newcomers to the Stockholm collector scene: youthful financier Hugo Pedersen and his beautiful wife Louise. The stylish pair are said to have a keen interest in art, and sources tell us that they have built up a sizable collection of contemporary pieces, despite having only been collecting for 2 years. "I've always loved the fragile, the complex," Mr. Pedersen cheerily told our reporter. Mr. Pedersen works for investment firm Fortem and has rapidly become a great patron of a number of artists. "If you're lucky enough to earn a bit of money, you also have to give back," he continued, heading off to mingle alongside his equally engaged wife. Johan W. Lindvall, 2007. Prologue. Adan dragged the aluminum ladder over to the back of the building and peered up at the balcony. The apartment was on Nystadsgatan, first floor. It shouldn't be too hard to unfold the ladder, lean it against the balcony, and climb up. But still, fuck. He felt like he was about to shit himself. Genuinely. He could just see it. Him at the very top of the bastard ladder with a brown stain on his ass. He had actually stopped doing jobs like this. He was 19 now and too old for break-ins. It was the kind of thing they used to do at the end of high school. Plus, it was beneath him now. But what was he meant to do? If Suri told you to do something, you did it. They had known each other since kindergarten, lived on the same block, played on the same teams. Their fathers had even been neighbors back in the old country. We were like everyone else in Backhol. We didn't care about one another more than we needed to, Adan's old man used to say. But everyone here thinks we're like family, like we're the same person. His father was both right and wrong. Suri was a brother, but he still acted like a dick. Adan could feel the chill of the ladder through his gripper gloves. Gloves. He had kept that part of the routine from before. His prints were guaranteed to be saved in a database somewhere. He braced himself. There was a lot of him to haul over the railing. He had to weigh at least 240 pounds. Still, the screwdriver was light in his hand, and the grip felt comfortable, as though his fingers had actually been longing to use it, despite his living a completely ordinary life these days. Drove a delivery van for his dad's boss, ate popcorn and watched Luke Cage and Fauda with his girl at night. It was just that 2 weeks earlier, he had been asked if he wanted to earn a little extra dough. Nothing illegal, just a one-day job for old time's sake. You were crazy if you said no to that kind of thing. It was all those German bastards' fault. What Suri had wanted was for Adan to travel down to Hamburg and pick up one of the new 7 Series BMWs. It was a done deal. You could get a 730D for under 100,000 euros there, then sell it without any trouble for 150,000 back in Sweden. The only problem: you couldn't register too many cars to yourself in any given year. Otherwise, the tax authorities would come sniffing. And that was where Adan came in. He had taken the train down to the southern tip of Denmark. A one-way ticket was 599 kroner, and he had spent the entire journey listening to Spotify on his new Beats headphones, keeping a tight grip on the fanny pack Suri had given him, and staring out of the window. 1 million kroner in euro notes weighed almost nothing. He had never spent so long on a train before, but it was actually pretty sweet. He never got bored of watching the scenery outside. It flew by. Frosty fields, wooded areas, and small towns where people seemed to collect rusty wrecks and old planks of wood. He wondered how they made a living. He'd had no trouble finding the car place, signing the documents, and negotiating with the salesman, who even spoke a bit of Arabic. It wasn't Adan's language, but he knew enough to be able to say a few friendly phrases. It felt sweet to sink back in the black leather seat, start the engine, and cruise back to Sweden. He drove different pickups every day, but never BMWs. This car didn't just look like it had class. You could feel the quality and the details, too. The smell of leather, the feeling when he ran his fingers over the dashboard, the weight of the doors, and the faint, comforting sound when they closed. He had thought about Suri. The guy did everything with style. Even his balaclavas came from sick French designers. One day, Adan might even be able to afford a car like this. But right then, his plan had been to drive all evening and night. He wanted to get the BMW home without having to check into a motel. It was on the highway outside of Jönköping that he first heard it, a hollow scraping noise that definitely didn't sound good. He had pulled over 2 miles later, climbed out, inspected everything, but he couldn't see a thing. The sound had returned the minute he pulled away. After another 12 or so miles, a warning light had come on. Brake fault. What did that mean? Shit, he didn't know if he could even keep driving. He had slowed down, causing a line of traffic behind him. He was going 40 in the 75 lane. The car sounded terrible. Another 5 or so miles later, he had pulled into a gas station and asked if the assistant could come out and check the car. The kid had spots all over his face and looked like he was 5 years younger than Adan. But he had immediately started shining a flashlight at the rims of the tires. "Looks like your brake pads are pretty much gone," he had said. "You can't drive another inch in this car. Shame with such a sick ride, by the way." That had been the end of the upside. Adan had had to pay a recovery van to tow the car to the next garage. It had taken 5 weeks to fix and cost $40,000. But there was also a risk it was pulling to one side, they said. Adan had called the seller in Germany and yelled at him, but the guy had pretended he didn't even speak English. In the end, Suri had a valuation on the piece of crap car. He wouldn't even get $600,000 for it. "How could you be so thick not to even check the car before you signed?" The lock on the balcony door gave way with a click, and Adan pushed it open. Suri had been clear. "The cops are keeping our guy who rented the place in custody, but they haven't found the shit there. So if you break in and find what's mine, we can write off half your debt. You know how much I blew on that car." Adan had squirmed. "Is anyone living there?" "Fuck that. There won't be anyone home tomorrow night either way." Adan thought back to one day in the yard when they were younger. Suri had fallen from the jungle gym, dropped like a little rock and cut his knee. To them, it seemed like a river of blood had come flooding out and the cut was full of gravel. His friend wouldn't stop crying. "I'll help you. Come on, let's go to my place. I think my dad's there," Adan had said in as gentle a voice as he could. They were 6 at the time, and Adan knew that his father could mend Suri's knee. Sure enough, he had. His father had cleaned the wound and applied the biggest band-aid they had ever seen. As they drank chocolate milk, ate cookies, and watched Toy Story on DVD afterward, Suri had said, "Your dad's better at that than mine." It was a 2-bedroom apartment. Adan switched on the light in what had to be the living room and saw a green sofa, a glass-topped coffee table, and a bookcase. There was also what looked like a projector of some kind. In both bedrooms, there were narrow, unmade beds. People had to be living there. Why else would there be newspapers on the coffee table and a t-shirt hanging over the back of a chair? At the same time, the place was also...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.